This is the time of year that has always been very auspicious for me, late October, early November. It was November 4th, 2013, where when I got up in the morning, I had this experience as I got into the shower of suddenly realizing what is meant by pure spaciousness. So, we're coming up on that. Today's the night of Halloween. It rained here today. It always rains on Halloween. And they had the Giants World Series parade today. Nobody puts on a better parade, I would say, than the Giants, San Francisco, celebrating a Giants World Series. It's quite the pomp and circumstance. But that's done. That's over. Time to flip the script. Turn the page. Flip the script. It is time. Just recognizing what's going on in the world, how there's this crystallizing of fourth dimensional belief in this world. This is really troublesome because the suffering, the misery, this world is sowing the seeds of misery, is what it's doing. I know this, having gone through the sufferings, fourth dimensional sufferings. They're way worse than the third dimensional. Third dimensional, so if you look back in history, and you know all the tough living conditions we had, people getting sick and dying of smallpox or some, you know, bubonic plague, and just, you know, tough conditions and okay, there's some misery, a lot of misery, but that's nothing compared to the misery of the fourth dimensional belief system, which is that of balancing out, you know, the opposites, trying to get them in harmony with the opposites in nature and all of that. That suffering is just incredibly terrible. You talk about unrelenting misery that has no name to it. So this is a desperate effort on my part, really, to try and to get into position eventually be able to help, because this is suffering that medicine, nothing can do anything for. And one lives in a state of tremendous fear and not knowing what in the world the fear is, because thinking that I just need to, somehow I'm a little bit out of balance, I need to balance, and yet there's this dread, there's this nameless dread. It's awful. So this world is sowing the seeds of future misery and suffering that seems to be intractable and cannot be treated. And yet all the while we're being bombarded with all these advertisements about, from here in the Bay Area, it's always about Stanford Medicine and all this, about how they have specialists for everything. Don't worry, we got you covered. Well, still working on chronic fatigue. So, you know, we've done some studies that seem to indicate there's some physiological change in the brains of people with chronic fatigue syndrome or Epstein-Barr syndrome, etc. I mean, I suffered from the chronic fatigue for decades and decades. But it was only until I really decided, you know, it doesn't matter. I'm not going to wait for any cure for this or that. And I just said, the problem is spiritual. Okay, it's not anything other than that. And the answer is spiritual. The answer is truth. The answer is realization. And so I just stopped, you know, viewing it that way. But, you know, it just shows you that these type of situations arise and arise and arise and arise. And they always say, don't worry, we're tracking down some genetic markers, we've seen some physiological markers, we're working on some, you know, medications. Or you see people, I saw some lady that they were treating for chronic fatigue syndrome, and then she showed in her hand just this handful of vials of all these antiviral medications she was taking. I mean, just unbelievable, you know, this is misery and still not cured, you know. And people keep looking for the answer where it can't be found. Punjaji says you must have great desire for God realization, and then keep that fire burning, prickling, until it consumes all other desires. And then eventually it consumes itself and leaves you without any thoughts, so to speak. Wow. Thank you. This is the remedy. This is the cure for all disturbances, really. There's one sovereign cure for all disturbances. This is what should be taught. And if it's not, all we're doing is sowing the seeds of future misery. And so, of course, those who see this have to flip the script, all right, and somehow abide in non-dual reality so they can get others, you know, going in the right direction. Because, of course, everybody mocks it, but once they come down with something like chronic fatigue syndrome, and nobody knows, everyone thinks you're a malinger or something like that, then they'll sing a different tune, for sure. When you come down with some very strong, intense disturbance, you sing a different tune. And you should, absolutely. You say, hey, I gotta find a cure for this. This is not, you know, the cure isn't optional. It's absolutely essential. And then you run around to all these doctors and they spend all your money and your time and you get nowhere. And then they send you out to all the psychiatrists and the psychologists and they get nowhere. And they tell you, we can't help you. And then you finally turn to spiritual help and you look at someone like Ramana Maharshi and say, well, I mean, he says he can help me, but he's so great. I mean, there's no way he can help me. You know, this little old me. I mean, how could anyone so awesomely, you know, this great, awesomely great spiritual mountain like that? That advice is only for, you know, someone else. It's not for me. And so you go through this struggle of thinking you're not worthy. You can't understand this. So I'd like to put it all in the context of continuity fear, and that levels the playing field because everyone has exactly the same problem. The intensity varies, but the problem is a continuity problem. And this is something that all the teachers know, that it's a matter of wearing away this, evaporating this continuity fear. And so everybody's on the same path. So the teacher's advice is for everyone. Everybody can be reassured and everyone can practice. There's nobody who cannot practice. Everybody can practice evaporating this continuity fear. And they will eventually get to where they understand very well what someone like Ramana Maharshi is saying to them. It's not unapproachable. Look at Punjaji coming to him full of arrogance, wanting to leave and thinking he's a fraud and angry and, you know, all this attitude, you know, and Ramana Maharshi wasn't part of it at all. So everybody has exactly the same problem. This is very important. It's only one problem, and thus we all share that one problem, the continuity problem. There is no other problem, actually. Everything else is just an expression, like the continuity fear just expressing itself, you know, and trying to avoid any evaporation, trying to avoid evaporation. Because the fear is saying, hey, if the continuity fear evaporates, you know, you will evaporate, or you will be perfect. You won't have any problems. And then we think, well, what would I do without any problems? No problems. So, yeah, we're on the brink of no problems. This is the great fear. This is the great fear that expresses itself in so many ways and will continue to do so. So when you have a culture that's obsessed with not practicing, not dealing with the continuity problem, not evaporating it, you're encouraging the continuity fear to keep trying to prevent evaporation, and that's when all these syndromes appear. Very terrible syndromes. And there's a lot of people suffering from all sorts of terrible disturbances and syndromes. You may not know it all, because most of us, we try to very, very best to pretend that everything's fine. I've gone through my whole life pretending, oh, everything's fine. You know, so there may be lots of people who are just, you know, really severe syndromes and disturbances, and they don't know what to do about it, except just, you know, go to a doctor. And it's so tragic. But even when you tell them, they still don't listen. That's the difficult part of it. But I would say, when the situation gets so severe enough, you might listen. Problem with all these medications is that's the continuity if you're trying to prevent listening. So it's very important to keep yourself alert and don't drug yourself down. Take whatever you need to take to keep functioning, but don't drag yourself down too much. You see, you still have to feel this like suffering to say, you know, I've got to find the answer to this. Whereas if you just take drugs and, you know, I just want to keep on functioning, get through life, and that's you're not going to really look and pay attention. I had the same issue with Ramana Maharshi's Punjaji, kind of. It's like, what's he doing sitting there silently? You know, what's that? And I just felt like he wasn't doing enough, not answering questions, you know, just silent. And so I struggled. I've always struggled with Ramana Maharshi thing, but now, no, not like that anymore. Is the way it's explained. I don't quite connect with the explanations of Vedanta. Do you have Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta, and I resonate more with the explanations of Jesus in terms of like a journey beyond words, A Course in Miracles. The way he explains it, I really get it, very much get it, and it's super powerful. But it's essentially saying the same. Also resonate with Longchenpa very well, very, very well. So it has to do with our backgrounds, probably. For instance, Punjaji was a Krishna Bhakti in a previous life in, I think it was southern India. And so, you know, there was an understanding of the culture, the words, all this stuff, that there's a compatibility. And so depending on previous lives, there'll be compatibility with various styles. Style. Spend your time listening to something that just seems to completely flip the script. Completely flip the script. Because something just, the inside, you just know, wow, that's true. Everything else is deception, self-deception. And this produces this feeling that you have like, the burn, as I call it. Okay, it produces the burn. So just full stop in the burn. So Ramana flipped Punjaji's script, saying, where you been? Like last week, couple weeks. Oh, Punjaji said, well, other side of Arunachala, playing with, what have you been doing? Playing with Krishna. He says, oh, okay. Yeah, well, that's great. Where's Krishna now? Ramana Maharshi asked him, and Punjaji said, he's not here, sir. He said, well, what kind of God is that, that leaves you? Look for the God that's with you always. Don't pay attention. Don't be looking for God in objects. God is the seer. Put your attention on the seer. You are the seer, not the seen. Ultimately, there's neither seer nor seen. It's just one. You see, so he flipped the script there. Flipped the script because Punjaji was always searching for an object. God is an object, something beautiful object. And he said, no, forget about beautiful objects. And he, you know, when he first heard that, he didn't like it at all. When he first went to see Rama Maharshi, didn't like that at all. So he left him, went back to Madras, said, wow, I don't like that. So he's flipping, having the script flipped entirely. So this is what's necessary. I mean, for me, Jesus flips my script in his, what he says. There's no such thing as accountability at all. There's no such thing as accountability. No such thing as process, time, space, process, form. The world has no value whatsoever. You know, just these ones, just like, wow. That is what makes progress. This is what evaporates the continuity fear. By entertaining this and just going through the burn of entertaining this, because you realize this is fundamentally transformative of, in terms of a belief system. And you have to move your comfort zone. Just move your comfort zone. So don't get comfortable. Keep on looking deeper for that which you're still, you know, still gives you a little bit of fear. Something really profound. Now, Punjaji was up in the where he lived, and I think it was in the Punjab, and he wanted to find God. He's been asking, been journeying all around India, asking people, can you show me God? Can you show me God? And one day this sadhu showed up at his house, and he asked his door, and he said, hey sadhu, can you show me God? Do you know anyone who can show me God? And the sadhu says, yeah, I know someone who can show you God. It's someone in southern India called Ramana Maharshi. Go see him. So when Punjaji went to see Ramana Maharshi and looked at him, he realized this was the sadhu that had come to his door. But people said, no, he hasn't left this area for, what they say, 48 years or something, a long time, that didn't leave here. And it's like, wow, what's going on? And then after the body of Ramana Maharshi has passed on, people still are experiencing in various ways, as I did in a dream, giving great encouragement. So, very, you know, there is powerful spiritual help in the world that somehow we come across. When we're willing to use it. But even so, the continuity fear is so strong that we only gradually glimpse, sort of dimly see, well, what is it they're pointing to? What is it they're really pointing to? So we have to be aware that this continuity fear makes the path slow, dim, difficult, and we shouldn't despair and give up just because we don't have some spectacular breakthrough. Most stories of those who finally succeeded talk about a long journey, odyssey of difficulty and disappointment and trying to find answers, find God, can't find it, frustrations. About for instance, Punjabi talking about how everything just fell into place. He didn't have any more money. He couldn't go visit Arman Maharshi. He looked at a newspaper or something. There was a job opening perfect for him. He applied. He got the position, got the money, traveled down to Madras. Everything just worked out, you know, just so he could go there. Now, you know, I find in the Western world here, things don't seem to work that way. But grace must be working in some way. It just has not come across to me the way that it's described in India through a lot of the writings there, how miraculously everything just falls into place and you know, all obstacles disappear. Well, it may be our obstacles have a different form or format or something, and we don't really see how that's happening. But it must be happening in some way. It just seems stylistically different here. For me, it seems like nothing has fallen away. You know, all the obstacles still remain. It's so bad. The obstacles are so bad now. I really need to just flip the whole script, the entire script. You know, just it's time to flip the script, because the script right now is terrible, absolutely terrible. I keep waiting, you know, where's that, you know, grace that you read about in the Indian teachers, and it just doesn't seem to show up like that. But maybe all this terrible stuff is just a push to flip the script. Possibly. This is what often teachers say, is... Don't curse the bad stuff that's happening. In fact, say, wow, this is a great opportunity. It's really pushing me very severely. But again, how do you flip the script? That's the question. I've been trying to flip the script my whole life. We say, come on, flip, time more timely, time this, be timely about this. But today, I don't know. Yes, I don't know. Yes, I don't know. I don't know. I do not know. This is a powerful, powerful, powerful statement that Jesus has said. When you can say this, and it rings true, and you feel this is really wonderful, he says, you're right there then. You're right. I have to go back and see exactly what he said, but it's you know, like the most auspicious indicator, the most auspicious indicator. So I'm right there. I'm able to say this, and I completely get it. I do not know. I do not know, because there's absolutely nothing to know. There can never be anything to know. There can never be any process to know. So of course I do not know. There can never be any situation to know. So of course I do not know. There can never be any circumstances to know. So of course I do not know. There can not even be any form to know. So of course I do not know. So yes, I do not know. As Giant fans, we don't say yes, we say yes, yes, yes. That's the little thing of 2014. Yes, yes, yes. So yes, 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 I do not know. I do not know, I do not know, I do not know. This is really basically saying, I am. I am the oneness. I am the isness. I am the nowness. I am the freedom. I do not know. I do not know. I do not know. So we have powerful, powerful tools to evaporate the cognitive fear. The maybe technique, maybe, 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 maybe. Very powerful. Many techniques, if they're easy to bring up if necessary. The only thing that's necessary is to actually do it. So we're all working on flipping the script so we don't suffer the misery that the seeds that are being sown now are certainly going to. It's like a massive crop that's being sown of tremendous misery. The worldliness, the lack of real practice here is astonishing in this world. The defenses, the unwillingness to really do what needs to be done, which is a difficult task, actually. The world's gotten very lazy, very self-satisfied, smug, thinking because they have these little gadgets that somehow that removes any necessity for them to do anything else. All they have to do is take a selfie and, you know, put it on, what is it? I don't know, some tweet it or make an Instagram video or Facebook it, and, you know, send it to friends. They feel that that's all they need to do. That takes care of their, you know, what needs to be done. So again, this is sowing the seeds of incredible misery later on down the road. I was at in a restaurant in the seventh game of the World Series, watching it, and everyone was celebrating. And I took out my little flip phone and I text somebody, yay! And someone saw the phone and says, "You got a flip phone." I didn't think those were any of those ever left. Where's you? He's like, "This is incredible." He said, "What?" I should have said, "Yeah, well, it's because I don't want to be distracted. I don't want my attention distracted." So you have to guard your attention very, very preciously and not let it be distracted. It's getting tougher and tougher to do. Tougher and tougher and tougher to do. The bureaucracy is becoming vicious. The lawyers keep writing more and more laws and laws and laws and laws and laws, putting them into laws. These laws then cause more and more and more people to get more and more trouble, more and more trouble. And then, of course, they go to lawyers to bail them out of all this trouble. It's and not denigrating lawyers per se. I'm just saying there's this cycle of bureaucracy is such that those who feed off this keep making more and more and more of it, and everybody's turning into making everyone, criminalizing everybody in a lot of different ways, and we have to give more and more and more and more. It's a vicious circle, and it's like the credit card companies here passing out credit cards like candy to children on Halloween, saying, "Don't worry, no interest, no nothing for, you know, 6 months, it's on us." And they get you hooked. They get you hooked on consumer buying, 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 buying. And after a while, you get in this habit where you end up putting a little bit too much on your credit cards, and it builds up and builds up. And when things go awry and you can't pay, then they jack the interest rate, you know, up exorbitantly and basically make you a slave. There's a lot of slavery going on in the world right now. The laws are, this is one of my pet peeves, of course. I say that men are being enslaved. True and truly, this is so. The whole legal system is not a legal system. It's a slave system. Okay. It's the laws only look at one side, really. Okay. They only look at one side. What did the man do wrong? Is basically what they say, you know. And they don't realize. They don't take into account the subtlety, the subtler role of the feminine energy. Here it has a much subtler role, and it has actually a greater role than the more masculine energy in the world. The world is this play, this mirage is fundamentally much more feminine than masculine, actually. And as said, the masculine is very disposable, so it gets blamed for all the problems, basically. And really gets enslaved. The masculine energy is enslaved by the feminine energy. And the legal system has been changed and tweaked in such a way that it doesn't take into account the role that the feminine energy plays at all in what's taking place in society, what's taking place in terms of this should not be happening, this should not be happening. So what happens is then the male energy has no recourse at all except to be basically blackmailed into slavery, intimidated into slavery by the legal system. So I say we don't have a global legal system. We have a global a slave code is what is the truth of this world is. Absolutely it is. And just you look at it, you just feel, just say, oh my God, I can't say anything. I can't do anything. I cannot really express at all. I can. You know, this is an imprisonment. It's an imprisonment. And this doesn't really benefit anyone. It doesn't benefit anyone. So is the seeds of incredible misery. In slavery, you cannot really, how you address others, you have to be very careful. You know, oh, I don't want to be disrespectful. I have to convince the slaveholders that I'm stupid. Okay, this is a central part of slavery, right? Is to make the slaveholders feel comfortable in their control. Is you're obligated to pretend to be stupid. And any of those who have been slaves throughout history know exactly what I'm talking about. And many of us have been there, done that. And you have to pretend to be stupid. You have to pretend like I don't know what I need to do. I don't know what to do. You have to tell me that I'm just a slave. You know? I can't. Freedom? I don't know. Freedom? What are you talking about? So you just self-censor yourself. What's taking place on this planet is a massive self-censorship of what I call the masculine energy on this planet. Massive. So now that they feel that they're pretending to be completely dependent on the feminine energy to tell them what to say, what to do, you know, what the agenda is, what the social agenda is, what the world agenda is, all this stuff. Slaves. Absolutely being enslaved. And nobody says a word about it. Nobody. See, that's part of being a slave. Slaves can't say they're slaves. They can't say, hey, I'm a slave. I'm being enslaved. This is terrible. No, they have to say, oh, this is wonderful. I'm so appreciative, Master, of your helping me out, giving me opportunity to serve you and be your slave. This is wonderful for me. I mean, I couldn't think of anything better that I like better. This is, you know, the quote Uncle Tom that kisses up to the slaveholders is to say, oh, yeah, you know, this is just like, I was born for this. I mean, I don't have any higher aspirations. What are you talking about? This is like perfect for me. This is perfection, as a matter of fact. And then the slaveholders say, oh, good, good. We can be comfortable then now. You know, it's not going to cause any trouble. Okay, this is great. You know, and make sure all the other slaves, you know, feel this way too. And so we don't understand this planet has been enslaved. It's a slave planet at this point. This is how I see it. Very, very, very bad slave planet. And people here, of course, they won't say that. They will not say that. They don't want to get in trouble. They don't want to get in trouble. We're already into a barbaric world. Again, the legal system is not really legal, a representative legal system at all. For example, if the feminine energy falsely accuses the masculine energy, it ruins their reputation, destroys their family reputation forever. Gets them to be fired, you know, just all this hellish stuff that happens. It turns out it's a false accusation. Nothing happens to the feminine energy at all. Nothing happens. But everyone just goes on and says, well, their masculine probably deserted anyway, even if it was a false accusation. It doesn't matter. Nothing happens, you see. This is a slave. When you can have false accusations like this, that's a slave condition. Someone to blame for everything. Someone to blame for everything. So these are the seeds that are being sown of tremendous misery here in the future. So again, the script has to be flipped. The script has to be flipped. The script has to be flipped. I've seen that everybody in the world's just basically capitulated. They don't see a way around this. Now, this is because we're stuck in duality. Dualistic belief system. Belief system of determinism. So it's not that everybody wants to succumb to this, by any means. It's that we don't feel we're able to, we just can't see past this determinate belief system, dualistic belief system. And indeed, it is very difficult to see past it. Which is why Jesus always told me to hurry up, work, study more, more attention. It's very difficult. Have to go fast. But the fact that it's difficult, this doesn't mean that we don't have it within us to be able to do this. We do have it within us. We can do it. It's either that or slavery. Plain and simple. The so-called golden age we're supposed to be going into right now is simply slavery. Of course it's golden for those who, they think it is for those who are controlling everybody else. It's not really golden for them because all this is just pretense. It's just pretense. Nobody's really a slave. Everybody's already free. This is a fact. There's no pit. Nobody's in any pit. Nobody is accountable. Nobody is guilty. There is no sin. There's only freedom. It's already the case. So everyone's just pretending. And of course, this pretense makes everybody jittery. Those who are pretending are afraid I drop the pretense. And those who are demanding the pretense are worried that maybe it is pretense and not real. You know, the Uncle Tom is just pretending. They're still a little nervous about it. So the trouble is we have it within us, but we just don't make the necessary effort. Plain and simple. We just keep thinking that the slaveholders will be nice to us, and they won't. They will not. They have severe continuity fear. Severe continuity fear is not going to be nice. It's going to be ruthless. So I say the problem is we don't recognize what our problem is. See, this is the problem. We do not recognize what our problem is. When we see and know that it's definitely a continuity problem, then we can really start working on it. This is what happened to me in 1978. I saw for sure it was a continuity problem. I woke up momentarily from delusion, the dualistic delusion. I saw very clearly I was free, and then I realized I was going to sink back into delusion, and I knew it was a continuity issue, 100% certain of it. And then I knew it was just a matter of time wearing this away, evaporating it, and I'll be free. So this is what is necessary. It is to know it's a continuity problem. Then you're just going to keep practicing no matter what and not make any excuses. But if you don't see it that way, then you're certainly going to make excuses and you won't practice enough and you're going to be enslaved. And then, of course, try to find some scapegoats to blame it on, and you may try and enslave others, you know, under you. Just like the plantation system, there are some that, you know, they have a little higher status, and they work the others, you know, really, really tough. And then there's others under them that even get worked, you know, more menial tasks. There's a whole, you end up in this horrible chain of seeming severity. Even though it's just a dance of continuity fear for everybody, still, it seems awful. So, again, the key is to recognize that we only have one problem, and that is the continuity problem. Nothing else stands in our way. As I've often said, it's like sitting on the ground, you're having a dream that you fell into some terrible pit. You've been struggling for so long to get free of it, and this awful stuff happening. And then realizing that you've never been in any pit. You're sitting on solid ground. There is no pit at all. None whatsoever. It's all just a hallucination. But then coming to accept this fact, you know, this is the continuity issue. It's like, wow. The misadventures I've been having, And in fact, it was all just a mental projection. And I never was in any trouble at all. So it's easy to use these words, but as far as feeling it goes, as far as actually, you know, accepting it goes, that's a whole different story. That's what takes the patience, the perseverance. And the practice, the patience, the perseverance, and the practice. Keep on getting more and more used to this fact that there was no fall from grace whatsoever. As again, how can we fall out of everywhere? Where is there to fall to? God's grace is all. Well, we can't fall anywhere. We never fell out of grace. All a dream, all a hallucination, an attempt to change what we are. So, we certainly pray every day to begin make more and more and more and more evaporation of this continuity fear. And then eventually there'll come a time when the script is flipped. The script is flipped. Eventually it will, just like Bunjaji, his script was eventually flipped. And it was flipped. Permanently, in this case, permanently. This actually will take place for us too, and we just have to practice, persevere, patience, keep bringing the burn up, keep bringing the burn up, the deep spiritual burn that is different than any other feeling, really. Nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever happened, actually. There's nothing to know, therefore. I don't know anything. I do not know. I am not a knower. I do not know. I am. We are not collectors of knowledge. I do not know. I am. I am. And since there's no knowledge, there's no thoughts, no concepts, there's just I am. The I am-ness. Continue to have dreams every night. My dreams are quite extraordinary all the time now. Can't even explain them. I'm reminded of a pitcher for the San Francisco Giants, Tim Hudson, who's I think 39, and has the most wins of any pitcher, active pitcher in baseball. Never even been to a World Series, never even a league championship. He started Game 7 of the World Series. He didn't do too well, but the team won. He now had a parade. He got his ring. He's just ecstatic. He's just absolutely ecstatic. It's just, that's what he aimed for, you know. And everybody's very happy for him. Well, he persevered. He's a very, very, very good pitcher. Really a phenom when he came up. But his team kept losing. Atlanta Braves, the Oakland A's, Atlanta Braves, they kept losing in the playoffs. He never got, you know, to the ultimate goal, but he never gave up. He never gave up, and he made one big last push. He says, maybe the Giants will get me a ring, and they did. You know, and he's just in seventh heaven right now in terms of, in these terms. So we should not give up. For me, I feel like I've been toiling away at this spiritual path my entire life for so long, and I still haven't flipped the script. But maybe somehow it will happen. Just like in Game 7, Tim Hudson went like an inning and a third or something, and it was like, wow, it felt so bad for him. But two other pitchers came in and did a fabulous job, and they ended up winning the game. So maybe someone will come in and help us out, you know, those who haven't given up and kept trying and trying. Maybe we'll get some help to help flip this script, like Punja G got the help from Ramana Maharshi. He finally went there, and said, just the gaze of Ramana Maharshi just purified his, and it felt like every atom of his body was, the script was flipped for every single atom in his body, until there was just nothing, you know, just this pure purity, pure silence. I do not know-ness, complete I do not know-ness, complete freedom, complete indeterminacy, complete I am-ness. It was the gaze of Ramana Maharshi that did it, actually, for him. So I don't know, you know, what's going to help us, but for sure, we have to keep giving everything we got. Even though, like, for me, I'm just burned out, you know, just totally burned out in just every direction possible. I'm just hanging on by a thread, just, you know, keep breathing, keep eating, keep stay alive. But the effort, the lifetime effort, it just burned me out. Just like Hudson, he's tired. He's tired. He's old. He's tired. He just didn't quite have it, but got some help. He had some help. Had some teammates to back him up. So I'm saying, like Jesus, Longchenpa, Ramana Maharshi, Punja G, Ananda Mahima, Nisargadatta Maharaj, they're our teammates. Actually, they are our teammates. It's all just one team. There's one team. And many more, you know, belong to that team. The real, true, non-dualists. And they, who knows what they will do. But certainly, we have to keep trying as best we can, even though we're burned out. Even though it seems like, you know, things are just going to fall to pieces soon. It's an auspicious time. And so for me, I'm still trying. Even though, again, the script has not been flipped. The continuity fear around it is much less. It's still some is there. Still some is there. Great thing if this script could be flipped, belief systems exchanged, no more sowing seeds of misery. Yeah, it'd be a good thing for the world. I mean, the way I look at it is, for me, I want to help everybody because I know that they need encouragement. We all need encouragement. Oh, I'm going to have trouble. So you want to be able to help. Everyone, minimize the suffering, minimize the delay, minimize the suffering, but in a way that actually is effective, instead of just trying to fix the problems. You go around fixing problems for people, then it just encourages them to maintain the causes, because you're just dealing with the effects instead of them. So they just say, oh, I can have my cake and eat it too. I can still have all this false belief and not suffer so bad from the problems. You know, slavery, essentially. They get people enslaved. And that doesn't encourage them to truly get free at all. In fact, it discourages them. So but in order to do that, you have to flip the script so people don't just use you, actually. This is what I found. I've just gotten used my whole life, actually. And people are very clever users here. Very, very clever. And until you flip the script entirely, you're going to be susceptible and probably pulled down by all that. And they say, oh, you want to help me? Okay, here's what you can do. Here, I got this problem. Everybody has, like, you know, infinite problems, actually. All sorts of disturbances. They say, well, get rid of this one, get rid of this one, this one. I say, no, I want to show you how you get rid of all of them. And they say, well, I can never do that. Take me too long. No, it won't. No, it won't. So you have to have those who insist it will not take too long. Yes, you can do it. You know, they choose not to. You just have to stay firm on that. Stay firm. And say, no, you can. Everyone can do it. Everyone must do it. So I don't want to remove the motivation, which is the suffering, the misery of the world is motivation. People say, oh, if I only had a nice house, a nice yard, everything, you should be my gardener, make everything nice for me. You know, no. Whatever, bloom where you are, whatever your situation is, bloom where you are. Whatever the difficulties of it are, the unpleasantness of it all, that should just drive you even more. Say, wow, I hate this situation. I really got to find answers. But unless you really know what the answers are, then you'll feel vulnerable to people, you know, demanding that you help them with their problems. Problems are an opportunity. Problems are an opportunity to flip the script. Say, wow, I really need to flip the script here entirely. So even though extremely difficult, don't give up. And hopefully we have a team behind us that will help us out. Certainly I accept what they're aiming towards. I realize they're telling us the truth. However much continuity fear clouds it up. So just have to keep on. That's it. Don't let a day go by where you don't try. Don't let a day go by where you don't try. Even if you don't succeed, you're still trying. You're still trying. Don't ever let go of this idea that you might succeed today. You might. Maybe the grace will occur sufficiently today and you totally flip the script. Free from the delusional belief in determinism, where you flip it so you know, oh, I don't know. I don't know anything. I do not know. That's great. Does the seer have a location? Does the seer have a location? See, the seen tends to think the seer is located somewhere because the seen thinks it has a location. But the seer really doesn't have a location. Does a seer need a location? There's a question, right? Does the seer need a location? Don't don't answer it. Right, full stop in that. Does a seer need a location? Just the raising of this question is causing a burn, right? It's a very, very profound question. Don't try to intellectually answer it. Does the seer need a location? Does it have a location? Does it need a location? We think of an appearance as having a location, but does the seer need a location? Like pure spaciousness, saturating everywhereness. Does it need a location in order for a bird flying through the sky to be within the spaciousness? Is the location of a bird, does that automatically then locate the spaciousness somewhere? Does the pure spaciousness need a location? Try not to get caught up in analyzing it too much, but keep asking the question. Say, hey, wait a minute. Muji puts it, can the seer be seen? That is a piranha question or something. Can the seer be seen? This is another way to put it. I mean, does it have a location? Does it have an appearance? Does a seer need an appearance? Does it need a location? Does it need a form? Does it need some determinacy? You see, as soon as we think the seer can be seen, we're saying, well, in order to see determinacy, there must be something determinate. But there is no determinacy. There is no process there. There is nothing bound one moment to another. So, try to answer the question. Just let the question marinate. Just marinate in the question. But what I just full stop in the burn of the question. The question is burning. It's like a fire that's burning. Just say, okay, just let it burn. Does the seer need a location? Does the seer need to be located? Does the seer need to be seen? Does seeing produce a residue? Does seeing produce a residue? Stop that. So this reaction came. Overwhelm me there. So I don't quite have the enough focus. That's okay. First step here. So we'll see how it goes from here. See how it goes from here. We're getting into again. Now this is even deeper territory. Deeper territory here. Which is what we need to do to flip the script. So just continue. Patience, practice, perseverance. That's it.